except today, I don't know. Except now, possibly, I'm
the chairman of the
Chairman of the Plaza and Luella.
Ashcott B, Kansas City, PA.
Larry Jones, Chinatown Corporation. Tony Point, Grand Star, Chinatown Corporation.
Andy?
Andy Boat, from the River State Park Partners.
Looking forward to the event. Let's remember how New Chinatown was established, because it was relocated, and we love having control of our own destiny, despite all the obstacles.
Definitely.
And I think that we'll move on. Any public comments? Hearing none, we're ready to go with just a quick update about our wonderful meeting.
Yes, so I'm Melanie. I represent College Station and Lincoln Park Bluff, so you'll see me pop up on the agenda quite a bit. But we had a DA hearing yesterday. They've taken it under consideration. They have a week. There's something with a sidewalk. Sidewalk needs to be looked at, but other than that,
I specifically remember hearing at the beginning of the meeting that Spring Street sidewalk was not required to be amended.
Correct. But at the end,
we will remind you on this CAS project, we met with Councilmember Reyes and I can't remember the name. Claire Owen, the lovely planner that did CAS, and we specifically pulled out College Station from CAS, the Cornfield of Rural Center Specific Plan, as it does, it made that parcel not available for housing, which didn't make much sense. The parcel was directly across the street from the gold mine. And it was a meeting that started 2 hours late. We lost, thank you to Larry for we lost and Shirley, not that she had any choice. Thanks to Troy for taking it out. But Homeboy Industries, the Fabulous Conservation Corps, East Wind Foundation for You, other residents, because they have life and they have things to do. There was, I want to say, at most two residents that decided to turn it down, who unfortunately did not really understand why they were. What does COG stand for?
Center for Nature Heritage.
Corporation of Grants Ordesma.
But everybody has willing to identify themselves and has introduced themselves, correct? Thank you. So, all right. Harmony, I thought that Sarah was gonna be here to say a few words. Judy, anything you wanna add for Harmony?
Oh, I'm not.
I realize that, but you're my explainer. And they just heard about what's going on.
Well, pretty much the entire project is, a lot by right, at least the business development. So we just started the entire process because it really important.
But the whole state has by right.
Well, I mean.
In the city of Los Angeles or in California.
Well, with the physical development of the site, the scale, that's all of it is by right. But I don't know where they're at in the process.
Gerald, anything to say on Washi, on Harmony or on conversation? You don't have to. Okay, I would say that the Harmony team has really, and the College Station team, and all teams have gone out of their way to meet with everybody that's asked to meet, which is not my definition of a stakeholder, but it is what it is. Again.
Also, with Lincoln Park Blocks, they just changed their name to Buena Vista. We've heard a lot of community, we've done a lot of community outreach and the community has spoken. They said they hated the name. So we scrapped the first design.
Wait a minute, what, you hated, they hated the first name?
They hated the first name.
Yeah, how many of them understood the second name?
This is the name. Buena Vista. For the coming months, we are meeting with stakeholders. We've done another touch on San Juan Canyon. We've done another touch on Chinatown. And we've done many meetings with Mount State Park. And so now I think it's, we're just meeting with many, many, many companies and stakeholders here in the local community. So if you would like to know more and like to see the design, please come see me. I will be around. We are refiling the NOP sometime soon. I'm in November. Don't have a date yet, but I will let you know once that date firms up. And I think that's it. Any questions?
Andy, you had some comments earlier about your thoughts on the second design.
Sure, I was just, we just had an informal discussion earlier.
Everything is
And the comment I wanted to make was, I was extremely impressed with what I felt was the listening to the community. Obviously, there are still concerns that folks have,
right.
But compared with what we saw a year ago, very clearly people were listening to the community concerns.
The architect developers, I let them know.
Have you talked to Mark, the architect, this week? Did he say anything about his experience at 88 Rising?
No, he hasn't. But he said that he brought many people to from his firm, and it was a great, he didn't really get into it, but he said it was a great event. So, and I went to Zed at the park, and it was a great event. You all did a great job making sure that it wasn't chaotic and the flow was on point. So,
I believe that yourself. What exactly is happening tonight at the park?
Okay, so tonight at 6:30 is an event called Bike Bike. And it is, the right person to really describe it, but it's there'll be a series of, I think they're called bicycle trains, which will be converging on LA State Historic Park from around the community, from around the city. And there are about 200 international visitors from, largely from South America and less so from Europe, who will actually be camping in the park over the weekend and celebrating, basically, bike access.
Okay.
real quickly on the MCMD?
I have a hearing set for October 31st.
For La Plaza, what are they asking for?
Master CUP for up to 10 venue.
That's all. On sale, off sale?
Up to 8 on sale and 2 off sale. So any combination, you could end up with 1, you could end up with 2, 8 to 10.
And, okay. Any questions for Judy on this or any other project? Oh, I know what you want to talk about. You had a question if you were, you presented something at the San Fernando Valley this morning, and your name and terms, what does that mean?
Oh, just because of certain requirements for labor.
Privately funded projects, private projects, are now being, the expectation is to meet with labor to come up with an agreement. So labor doesn't attend meetings to quote them, even though there's no subsidy, no barriers, no extraordinary position that's being taken by the city to allow housing to be needed. Right? Is that pretty much it?
Yes.
Okay. So, all right, I think maybe no more questions on the projects. Moving forward, I think, you know, we have spent an inordinate amount of time addressing homeless individuals and their concerns. Whether or not these individuals are from our community, it is a community, city, state, nation, county, nationwide problem. Towards that end, we've brought in Melissa Ordovia from the city to discuss, plans. Christina Miller came by, the current homeless czar. We're in constant contact, and we're doing constant outreach and constant cleanup. We've been fortunate enough to meet with the people concerned, who is the operator of the El Pueblo Lot 5 shelter, and also the operator of PSH Holden, which is a shipping container project that's opening tomorrow, a project that is entirely privately funded with a projected 5% return on their first project. This is also a project that can be start to finish, meaning occupancy, in 7 months. And the city involvement is minimal because these are approved prefab structures approved by the state. And this is a small project by right on a small lot, and it's not a massive project. Yet the city is not moving forward on this. You know, they know of it. Yes, a few of them will show up tomorrow for the delivery study. But why are we can't build our way out of this mess? And we need these both lot 5 as transitional and the permanent supportive housing. And when we proposed this at Lot 5, comments back were, why aren't you building this in Chinatown? Let's build this in Boyle Heights. The Archdiocese said, let's stop the feeding program here and we'll restart it somewhere else. And it, to me, and Christina, and Connie, and Elisa, who were on site, it made the most sense to build the shelter where the services are needed. So without further ado, Kate has been very gracious in allowing us to pop in and bring in a lot of people to take a look at it. We have experienced this yourself. So Kate, please.
Stand so that my voice carries over as best it can. I'm Kate Peters, I'm the Chief Strategy and Integration Officer at the People Concern. The People Concern is a long-standing nonprofit focused on homeless services. We've been at it for more than 55 years, and we operate a number of shelters across the county, Santa Monica, downtown, right on Skid Row, and we've got the Care Center on the city, the mayor's office and council member, we are felt that we would be good partners to operate the first of the original shelters, which is the one that opened just down the street, not quite 3 weeks ago. So I'm happy to answer questions about anything that you may have. I thought it may be helpful for you to hear a little bit of an update on what's happening at the Lot 5 shelter. As you know, there's capacity for 45 residents, and we are at capacity. It only took 2 days to get everybody moved in. We have 15 women and 30 men. I understand there's one woman who is not comfortable in the shelter situation that we have there, so we're working with her to find another shelter that we're going to. So we have 40 more tonight, but we also have a wait list of 61 people from the immediate area. So we're prepared to move people in immediately as beds open up. Some of you may be familiar with the LASA and D6 outreach teams who have been working in the neighborhood for many months. They are our close collaborators in connecting with the people who are outside and on that waiting list, so that when we know that we'll have a space opening up, hopefully, for the most part, because people are moving into housing, we'll be able to get somebody in within 24 hours to keep the beds full. We are aware of two permanent housing placements that happened within the past month. There were two people who were supposed to move into the shelter, actually, but got matched to permanent housing before the shelter opened. So they moved right from the Elm Promenade streets into permanent housing. One of the things that people concerned has been doing for a long time and does quite effectively is provide supportive services to help people maintain their housing and not end up homeless again. So that's how we partner with a lot of the work that we do. And I'm aware of two additional housing matches that have been made of those original 45 people. So we should have another housing placement pretty soon. As Jordan was alluding to, the thing that is going to slow us down is the inability to match people with housing that they shelter. There is not enough affordable housing for the poorest of the poor among us, and so we will continually run up to a challenge of having people who are ready and anxious to move into housing, but not having the resources available to do to give them that little unit. We've got a number of staff who are dedicated to that site full time. We have a brand new director who will be starting next week, Lee Daniel, that everybody will be excited to meet. Our director of all of our interim housing, a woman named Isabel, has been there on site primarily, so Daniel will report for her and will be dedicated full time to that location. We have two case managers and one clinical case manager, a mental health professional, who are full time dedicated to that site, as well as on site security 24/7. And additional staff that we call attendants or client monitors to be there 24 hours a day, including overnight. We are just starting to bring in community engagement as it makes sense and as people are interested. So that might look like doing an in-kind donation drive. We're hearing the need for clean medicines that could be donated, gently used clothing items, toiletry items, and new socks and underwear are things that folks always need there. I'll tell you one really brief anecdotal story. There was a gentleman who moved in on the first night, and after the second night, the staff learned that he hadn't actually slept in his bed yet. He was sleeping on the floor. And the staff said, what's that about? And he divulged to them that he only had the clothes that he was wearing on his back and they were filthy. And he didn't want to sleep in his brand new bed with filthy clothes, but he wasn't quite quite sure about the logistics of getting a shower and getting a clothes wash. And so rather than soil this brand new bed that was so important to him, he felt so honored to have, he thought he should just sleep on the floor. So we got him new clothes, he's sleeping comfortably in his bed now. But I hope that that conveys to you of how appreciative and respectful the folks who have moved in feel about having this location and how serious they are taking this opportunity. Other questions? Any specific people that I would talk about?
All of these individuals are from the media blog, which is 101 Freeway, the Cedar Commons, Alameda, Dallas,
yeah.
Right? And as of last week, we have got somewhere almost 50 people off the sidewalks in this area.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I realize it's a drop in the bucket for what's needed, but think about how what a difference that is, and why was it so challenging to build. This is why I'm always communicating this to you. And it's important. Look, we've gone from Get Out back in the 70s and 80s to now Housing First. It's my understanding that individuals that may come back after a day on the town are still welcome back if they're able to functionally get into bed. They're not excluded. And, you know, there's how many animals there now? I mean, you know, how many dogs?
We only have one right now, but there's room for more. If somebody has a pet, we will work very hard to accommodate whatever pet that might be. Mostly dogs, but we're prepared for it as well.
How else, other than communicating to more to electeds, or not supporting electeds who want people to leave, what else can you do?
Well, I appreciate the point you made about the modular housing, that this project of having homes is opening tomorrow. It's the first, we hope, of many that went a lot faster than how many developments in a need to go. The issue is permanent supportive housing, that the answer to any homelessness is more housing than people who don't need it. While it might seem this way, there is no question that that is the answer. And the more of us who say, we need more of that, so that we can actually solve this problem, rather than continuing to put a band-aid on it, the more likely it will be that our elected officials will hear us and continue to look for creative solutions, faster solutions. I think that's what's nice about this shelter is that it was a parking lot. And it has now been used creatively to bring 45 people off the street and hopefully many more.
You know, I think one thing I forgot to mention, when I say that is council members, the EO staff has been very supportive. Gerald and I walked through. We're going to take a separate tour of Martha Poodle and play to your place and to PSA Colton, just so they can see it. During the delay when all the respect to the city was pushing back, was it 14, and parts of the mayor's office and multiple merchants were pushing back, the city, at least his team, identified two sites in Chinatown, south of Homeboy. Met with Homeboy, those sites are ready and able to be used. And you can see how zero impact and helpful this first model has been. And it's my understanding as the second location for a transitional facility has not been selected.
That's my understanding.
Do you have internet yet? You have cable internet. So it's, for us, okay, when Dawson Plaza opened, was there internet? How do you do this in this day and age with all the volumes of forms that have to be pulled out? You open a facility without internet. These poor folks are working off their cell phones, tethered to their computers, or working off their cell phones. So we just have to make sure that we push these public signs
function. Better function. Okay, any other questions for Kate?
Call back pretty quickly.
You could, something that set up by the county, by Mazda, and it's, I think it stands for Los Angeles Homeless Outreach Portal, is what it is. And so the website is la-hop.org. Homeless Outreach Portal, yeah. la-hop. And what that is intended to do is become a database where outreach requests can be submitted, and then there becomes a record that request has been submitted. It gets triaged to the appropriate team geographically, and then there's a responsibility on the team to follow up. That anybody can use that anywhere in the country.
There is a 611 flyer that we, at the request of Lisa, translated the Chinese, and then we translated the Vietnamese. We used one time each for a Chinese speaker who was not homeless, who comes in from Walnut Panhandle on Broadway Bay. And then a Vietnamese individual who was already in the system, we made contact with him. And that's strictly the guidelines of engagement other than within the skill boundaries.
Okay. Anything else for Kate?
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Maury was going to come and update us on various city ordinances that were on. He is stuck operating the same sort of thing that he was stuck at yesterday. So we'll move past that. Any other questions on? Okay. Tomorrow is the 8th. Well, tomorrow we're celebrating the 8th and it's called Carol. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, and because you sit there so nice and quiet, Sharon would have pulled up. There is a project submitted in CAST. Right?
Yes.
Can you give us a quick update on that? The first project, as I understand, residential project submitted in CAST.
Developers submitted for plan check an approximately 200-unit mixed-use project in the CAPS. Because the way the CAPS is written, it is probably entirely by right.
Do you want to talk about by right again?
Yeah, so in the CAPS, site plan review is not required. Because they've already analyzed all the effects of the EIR. Off the top of my head
because
I didn't expect to talk about it
today. The project is on Vestinger Street, at the corner of Vestinger and Nod Street. Okay, Gerald, you're up.
Yes, I'm Gerald Lutton. I'm sitting with my deputy at the Council's office. Thank you for inviting our office today. I wanted to speak
everybody's
about
always welcome.
The Cornfield Arroyo Seco Specific Plan, also known as the CAS. And I have copies that don't have. Motion by Councilman Cedillo without any copies. So, July 2013, Councilman Cedillo was elected following the tenure of Councilman Reyes. In August of 2013, the council adopted the CAS and it became effective. So, we were evaluating the CAS because from 2013 to 2018, it now has been 5 years. And during that 5-year period, in all honesty, there's been zero housing production. So we thought it was timely to ask the planning department to evaluate those policies. The theory behind the CAS, I believe, in many instances, is to create incentives to attract kind of mixed income housing and incentives to introduce affordable housing with market rate housing. However, seems to be a lot of confusion or questions around of these incentives. So as a result, Councilman Cedillo has introduced a motion, and I'll share copies of it in your card, this was, the impetus of this discussion was around the Lincoln Heights Jail development. The Lincoln Heights Jail is a city-owned asset, which has stood vacant for many years. And the city family has been looking at our city-owned assets through a different lens, so that we have identified those sites that present economic development opportunities. The city has also has the Affordable Housing Opportunity Sites program, which is where the city is looking at city-owned parking lots or other city-owned properties that could be suitable for affordable housing, for permanent supportive housing. So an example would be 5 parking lots in Lincoln Heights, which we are reviewing for potential permanent supportive housing, but also a mix of senior affordable, family affordable, even workforce. So Lincoln Heights Jail started this discussion. Basically, the CAS created new zoning categories. One category is called urban village. And the basic parameters of urban village can have up to 85% as residential land use. So a lot of the urban village land is zoned right around the Cornfield Park. So we think that makes sense, creating density around an urban open space. The other category is called urban innovation. And urban innovation kind of flips the formula. Urban innovation limits residential use to 15%, with the balance being industrial, commercial, hybrid industrial. And the theory, as I'm told, is to preserve a job base or create a base of land that can create jobs. So across the street from the Lincoln Heights Jail is a site that is on urban innovation. And the developer owner of that site submitted a bid for the Lincoln Heights Jail redevelopment. And the city felt the better scheme rose to the level because it incorporates both the jail site and their site. However, it's zoned urban innovation. And that's where we discovered the planning department making interpretations which were not really feasible, and honestly, even flip-flopping in their interpretations. So that, for example, the interpretation to take advantage of certain incentives, the site must be built out to the full floor area ratio before taking advantage of certain incentives. And when talking to investors, the real estate development community, that would be infeasible. It would be infeasible. So, next Tuesday at 2:30 in City Hall, I only have 20 copies, the Planning and Land Use Committee of the City Council, known as the PLOM, Planning and Land Use Management, will take up this appeal motion. So I'd like to invite anyone who's interested or wishes to comment or even support our motion to come out to City Hall. It's at 2:30 on the third floor. And if the council adopts our motion, we'll basically instruct the planning department to use the interpretation that's not infeasible, that's not like a incentive, it's almost becomes a penalty. But also we're asking for an amendment to the plan that would address that issue. And we're also asking for a report back for a 5-year evaluation of the policies of the past, just to, in light of the fact that from 2013 to 2018, I'll do this, we've had zero production. That's very frustrating because the plan was touted as a plan that would incentivize mixed income housing. Just an editorial note, ironically, those sites that are actually developing are outside the CAS. Ironically. So what does that mean? I don't know. So I used to work with a former councilman at Reyes. He's a friend of mine. I do want to have a conversation with Mr. Reyes about this. 5 years hence, as the principal author of the class. I mean, there's so much opportunity, you know, in this area, and we'd love to see a community build up around the park. There are good things in the past, I believe. There are actually good things that facilitate approvals. When we first got elected, LA Kitchen in Lincoln Heights, a 60,000 square foot warehouse, kind of took advantage of the rules. Was able to be up and running in partnership with Robert Edward Group from New York, does food security and things like that. So
Thank you, girl. I'm my last. CASP has been, the first thing we, when somebody talking about a site, is approaching that me and I, little too, we can't remember this stuff. So you just, I have a, you know, a markup folder. But I think in the 5 years, and, I mean, 4 years after adoption, you know, and then the
keep it under consideration.
College Bay, Alhambra. We brought LAPD in to address the issues. That particular side of Alhambra Avenue was actually in CD14. Unbeknownst to all of us until, CD1 brought them to our attention. So we're continuing working on that. Illegal dumping is a daily issue. Some of you have seen, so on Tuesdays, I'll spend time pre-funneling requests for Cadet Manor, many of our residential projects, Natia or Blossom, to report bulky items to Wednesday's pickup day. I will continue to do that for parts beyond the district boundaries, but it is out of control. There was a situation on New People that some of you saw the photo of, where just literally seemingly a half block of trash and debris or street sweeping has been missed. Bulky items that were not picked up. CD1 assisted, but I only found out a couple of days ago that the property owner, which is Leslie Wong, the dentist on Broadway, had paid somebody to remove all the trash and debris because she had a housing inspection that was coming up. That seems to me like a double whammy, and certainly something that, again, Ricardo and Hugo knows well of my issues with Yale Terrace is a prime offender. Cadet Manor has at least finally gotten to the point where they're bringing out the bulky items late night or Tuesday and all making their people money request. Let's be real, the senior citizens, residents at Cadet Manor are not the ones moving the stuff down to the sidewalk. It's done by Cadet staff. So what would you want? Unconditioned alcohol sales, same issues at within the district. At Highball Market, daily, Walmart Mini Market, daily, out of the district, CDS, except they don't come back and hang out with me. And then rental living. So these are all things that, without generating calls to LAPD and have LAPD documentation, there's no revocation possible. And I believe the revocation unit is no longer in operation, correct?
No.